It's been nearly a week since Hurricane Maria slammed into Puerto Rico. The mayor of San Juan calling the situation on the island a humanitarian crisis. Power is out and supplies of food, water, fuel, medicine are dwindling. CNN's Bill Weir has more from Puerto Rico.
Beside a highway in Utuado, this is the most dependable utility in rural Puerto Rico these days. A pipe tapped into a mountain spring is now the watering hole for a community of over 30,000.
It's a natural spring.
It's a natural spring. It's always here.
And are you boiling it or you drink it straight?
You can drink it straight. This is cleaner than the water you get from the Department of Water Resources.
Okay, well, that's good. You've got that.
Yeah, this is cleaner than that.
How's everything else in life? How are you got enough
awful.
Food, power? Awful.
Awful, awful. There's people that have a shortage of food. The National Guard is not working up to the way it should be. They're all just standing there doing nothing. No electricity, no water for the city. It's going to take like about maybe 6-7 months for anything to happen here.
While safe from coastal storm surges, Maria brought hellish mudslides to mountain towns like this, cutting off families for days and forcing desperate decision-making. Do you burn precious fuel searching for supplies or stay put and pray for help? Lydia has two cars with no gas, two grandkids to keep alive on a ration of crackers. With no way to reach that highway pipe, they drink rainwater. No water, no food, she tells me. It's nobody's fault. It's the weather. You have to go on. I can tell the anxiety. I can tell my heart breaks for you. What worries me the most is my family doesn't know how we're doing, she says. We don't have cell phone connection.
On a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being horrible, desperate, where are you?
8.
You're an 8.
8, yeah, yes. And 8 going bajando.
8 and getting better, the young mayor tells me. If the gasoline arrives, it will fix our problems because people are starting to get desperate. Gas is more precious than water up here. National Guard vehicles can't move. Worthless ambulances sit idle. The hospital has one day's worth of generator fuel left and one volunteer doctor because the rest of the staff has no way to get to work.
Are people starting to turn on each other?
Nah, sí.
Yes, he says. There's been situations where people are stressed out, crying, folks with dialysis, patients with cancer, bedridden patients who need ventilators.
Everything you can help with the voice in the outside because I need gasoline and diesel.
I will tell the world.
The fuel shortage is even more evident in San Juan, where lines are miles long.
They open this particular service station at 6 a.m. They run out of gas by 3 p.m. So some people at the end of this line may not get the fuel they need. The folks here are telling me that a local ring of gangsters called Titere, drug dealers, actually commandeered a gas station, took over two lanes just so their guys could get the fuel.
How would you describe the level of desperation?
Oh, to the highest level. And not only here in the metropolitan area, but in the center of the island, in Utuado, Barranquitas, Naranjito, is very, very bad. And they are suffering, everybody's suffering, and let's see how we can work it out and begin again.
You're putting a brave smile on it, but
I will always do that, of course.
And someday, after the most primal needs are met, parents will have to figure out how to send their kids back to school. And at Wesleyan Academy, this is what awaits. There is so much to rebuild, and so many now considering leaving this island for good.
What message would you have for folks back in the mainland?
Well, we just have to keep calm. That's all I can say, just keep calm, because like I said, if this week I told my family, if this week we don't see anything getting better, I'm gonna have to leave the island. I've been here already like 20 years, and I'm gonna have to leave the island. I don't have any other choice.
Bill Weir, CNN. Utuado, Puerto Rico.
I want to bring in Congresswoman Nydia Velazquez, a New York Democrat who is chair of the Congressional Hispanic Caucus. Congresswoman, thank you so much for coming in and talking about this important story. We're going to put up two satellite images on screen. There they are right now. Before and after images of Puerto Rico. You can see the almost complete lack of power throughout the island. What do the people of Puerto Rico need most right now, you think?
Definitely to restore the infrastructure because it basically collapsed. Electricity, the power grid, that is so crucial, so that hospitals in Puerto Rico could be able to open for to provide the services, because these are life and death issues related to the power grid. Mm-hmm. And people are, they don't have access to water, food, medicine, basic things that could, you know, have an impact on the elderly and the children. So we are concerned, and right now, some of the many information that I'm getting from friends in Puerto Rico is that they are in the brink of a human crisis. If not, they are already facing a human crisis.
Well, let's talk about what's happening here, because the FEMA director, Brock Long, spoke about the federal aid being delivered. Here he is, and then we'll talk.
We have 16 ships currently operating that we haven't talked about in the media. We have 16 ships currently operating. That's a combination of U.S. Coast Guard and our DOD partners. We have 10 ships en route, 10 ships and barges en route over the next 48, continuing to bring, you know, generators, emergency power, as well as more additional food and water that's coming in.
He said they're doing all they can do, but if more people don't get help soon, you fear more will die?
Don, 6 days later, after Maria hit, and now they're sending 16 ships. Of course, that we welcome it, but the whole world knew that there was a Category 4 hurricane that was about to hit Puerto Rico. We didn't have a plan in place in terms of having the kind of response that was needed, given the nature of the devastation that was expected to cause, to be caused by such a disaster, a natural disaster.
Why did you say that this could today, that this could be President Trump's Katrina, Congresswoman?
Because the help that is needed is not there. Mm. Believe me, there's so much devastation. There are isolated, remote areas where we have seniors, where we have elderly people, people that are trapped in buildings, 24 and 20, 21 story buildings. And these seniors, is very difficult to reach them. So that is today, I believe, if not late yesterday, two more people died while they went to a hospital to seek services.
But why do you think it wasn't handled better? Why do you think it wasn't managed better in your...
Well, I was frustrated watching the news throughout and the TV throughout the weekend. There was too much attention given to other things that didn't have to, well, like athletes and tweeting out
the football about, and NFL.
Yes. So while there was a plight by the people of Puerto Rico and all of us throughout the United States, so many people and reporters talking about the dire need of the Puerto Rican people. And today is when we hear that FEMA is sending, or the Navy is sending 16 ships. That is the type of response that needed to take place 6 days ago and not 6 days later.
Well, Congresswoman, we appreciate your time. Let's hope that they get Puerto Rico gets the help that it needs and the people there. And we appreciate you so much. Thank you.
And by the way, if I could mention, today I'm sending a letter to the president with 105 of my colleagues asking for the appointment of a top senior military person to oversee the operation, plus to station the aircraft Abraham Lincoln. We did it for Miami. We should do it for Puerto Rico and for the Virgin Islands.
Yeah, a general like General Russell Honoré, someone like that to
That's
go in
correct.
And help. Thank you, Congresswoman.
Yes. Thank you.
That's it for us tonight. Thanks for watching. I'll see you right back here tomorrow.